Hello students, welcome to the series on business communication. Today we are going to study interdependence in business communication. In this, we are basically going to cover the nature and the concept of business communication in terms of interdependence, the impacts which are generated by the interdependence communication, the interlinkages in the organization, and the kind of the structure in terms of global economy. Now the world economy is connected in form of like a spider web, where all the countries are interlinked together in terms of resources and in terms of the assets which they share with each other. The impact of interdependence or interlinkage communication has become important because the power which is genuinely emerging in the global economy has impacted the people's life to a larger extent because of the connectivity through technology. It is also because of the deepening impact of the globalized systems existing in the world economy. The interdependence has become important to build up a harmonic relationship between the various countries of the world. In the words of R.O. Keohane, interdependence can be defined as situations in which actors or events in different parts of a system affect each other. So in this, the intergovernmental bodies and the interinstitutional bodies become important, and they become the catalytic agents, sustaining the relationships in a mutually beneficial way. Interdependence is important because you have to manage for sharing of resources, for sharing of the political and the cultural relations, and sharing of the kind of the ethical business practices so as to build up a democratic system. The economic change impacting the life of the people has gone a long way in deciding the mutual relationships. This kind of economic linkage is genuinely helpful in building up the competitive advantages in terms of profitability and growth in the business systems. The changing lifestyles of the people through technological upgradation in form of gadgets has impacted the connectivity systems. The world has become a global kind of a village where every person is connected to the another person in terms of the internet or the web. The institutional changes have impacted the world economics. These changes have resulted in a kind of mutual cooperation, into kind of multilateral agreements, in kinds of the intercultural communication built up through common languages, protection of human rights, and in terms of spreading democracy and world level of corporate governance. This institutional changes has also impacted the mutual understanding, which has resulted in form of agreements, treaties, and protocols. The global governance has resulted into a global democratic system where a participation in terms of global economics has become important. This has reinforced the development in terms of dialogues emerging between various countries and various institutions. The best example of the success of interdependence communication is the European Council. This council emerged because of the cooperation of the countries between each other. They have eased out the legal and the other barriers so as to sustain business relationships. The passport and the visa requirements have been eased out. There has been a kind of foreign same currency existing in all countries for better exchange of goods and services. This kind of forum has resulted into business in terms where the resources and the raw materials can be shared in an easy way. The transportation cost can be cut down, and the kind of the change or the impact on the business order has been genuinely happened in an easy way. The result of this European Council is a kind of an example built up for the world economy to resort to interdependence. The Council of Europe says, the communication in such process is a process that comprises an open, respectful exchanges of views between individuals and groups with different ethnic, cultural, religious, and linguistic backgrounds and heritage on the basis of mutual understanding and respect. This kind of cooperation has resulted into a kind of accepting of the cultural diversity, into a kind of accepting of democratic systems in such a way that the participation has become easier for people. It is the respect for the human rights. It is the respect for the different castes and cultures of the people who are working together in the global systems. it is a kind of a system where easy change or easy exchange of information is happening through dialogues, through treaties and protocols. Let's see in this diagram the intercultural communication which is built up in the kind of the systems we are existing. The intercultural communication has resulted into the democratic governance of the cultural identity, has resulted into learning and teaching of intercultural competencies, has resulted into intercultural communication in international relationships, has given space for intercultural dialogue, and has given democratic citizenship and participation. The basic benefits are also shown in this diagram, where the intercultural communication has resulted into a skillful working of people together, adapting comfortably to living to different cultures, learning to interact with international partners as equal, understanding the worldwide political cultural environment, and developing multiple cultural perspectives. So these are the basic impacts which the interdependent or the intercultural communication has resulted into a kind of benefit where different people from different areas are able to work together. This has helped in the easy way of communication and interaction, which has increased the efficiency. In the words of Allen in 1995, the active policy of interdependence has resulted on the revival of intercultural and transcultural activities. Why these are important? Because international cultural relations is a resource for power in international relationships. Now let's study the social interdependence theory. This theory was created by Morton. He said that the organization has to share work relationships in order to give better results. The socially independent organizations are not relevant, but it is socially interdependent organizations which are necessary to build up the work relationships and powerful kind of equations for diverse work cultures. The social interdependent kind of a system in which the individuals share common goals from different cultures. They are affected by the actions of one another because here you are into a kind of a mutual cooperative relationship. The relationships can be of two types. It could be competitive and cooperative. In kind of the competitive relationship, we believe that one person could gain at the cost of the other. But in cooperation, the group results are important, the teams are important, and each individual commitment adds up to the group goals. So the interdependence in terms of cooperation is important. This cooperation leads to a kind of achievement and retention of good people in the organization. It gives a kind of willingness to do the difficult tasks. It helps in higher reasoning and understanding of the particular process and business. It also helps the individuals to work for better aspects in the organization with giving equal attention to all the activities of the organization. So this cooperative interaction is necessary because it gives you a kind of help. It helps you to solve the complex problems. And it also gives you the better feedback to take up the results to the higher level. It helps to promote better interaction between countries, cultures, and people. Now, how to create a kind of a cooperative system in which positive relationships are bestowed? This kind of interdependence can be resulted when all the members are given equal importance. All the cultures are respected. Each person should be made accountable for his task. The credit should not be taken from the persons because once you give credit to people, people work for their own recognition. This is the development of the skills in terms of training and education is necessary because when people are developed, they work for better results in terms because they get rewards for whatever they do. There are ways to relate people in terms of interdependence. First is dependence, then is codependence, then is independence and interdependence. This is a kind of a person who generally thinks that he cannot do anything on his own. And then codependence is a person who genuinely will believe that he is dependent on other person and the other person's goals are more important because he is more powerful and his dreams are not important. But in independence, a person achieves the ability to take a decision-making power where he thinks that he is right and the other people are not right. He has a selfish approach of attaining goals in terms of independent approach. Then is interdependence. This is the highest level of human specialization where people work together in networks and in relationships where the complicated tasks can be completed, because here the kind of synergizing of skills happens. So this relationship, and when people reach to this kind of aspect of specialization, a kind of a fruitful relationship exists, which genuinely results for better profits in the work relationships. Employers also want people who can work in teams and who can relate to the other people in terms of interdependence. Here you have to have a communication style which genuinely results into a kind of a solving of a purpose, the communication which is honest and communication which is responsible. So a kind of interdependence communication is a style of communication where you respect the views of the other people in terms of their behavior, their perceptions and their cultural distinctiveness in order to achieve your goals. Now let's study interdependence patterns in the organization. The basic patterns of interdependence which exist into the organizations are, first is grouping, then is linking and alignment. In grouping, we genuinely differentiate the groups together on the basis of function, product or style. In linking, we basically integrate the kind of the functions across the cultures and across the organizations. And in alignment, we basically align the special tasks in such a way that the cross-cultural teams in terms of specializations are built up. When we give a task, genuinely it has to be designed on the basis of these networks. Task independence from low to high, or from genuinely complex to easy tasks, are designed in such a way that you get forms of interlinkages or forms of interdependence. Let's see, in this diagram we have a kind of three forms of interdependence. First is pooled. In this, we have shown you that various resources are pooled up in this kind of central authority. Then is sequential. In this kind of relationship, when one task is completed, then only the other task can be completed. So this is a kind of a sequence of task relationships built up. The reciprocal is when you try to do functions in terms of reciprocating to each other. When one task is completed, the other person has to do in terms, and then he has to communicate to the third person, and the third person again has to communicate to first or second. So in this way, a kind of a continuous kind of exchange of reciprocal actions or thoughts take place, by which we are able to build up a kind of a product or a relationship. The strategic grouping of the networks or the interdependent team is done by the expertise and by the output and the market requirements. We also have the hybrid kind of organization structures where we can pool the two different designs to build up the matrix kind of the organization structure. Let's see the functional kind of the grouping structure. Here we have a kind of a headquarter where we have the functions like engineering, marketing, and maybe it is marketing and sales put together. And then you have manufacturing. Then you have the differentiation or grouping on the basis of the product. Suppose a company is manufacturing two products, product A and product B. So the grouping for product A will be again engineering, manufacturing and marketing. For product B, it will be engineering, marketing and manufacturing, again in the same way. The strategic linking is on the basis of the hierarchy and on the basis of the interlinkage and the kind of the integrator's role. This strategic alliance could be permanent or could be temporary. There is a kind of a constant kind of a technological change and exchange of information in this kind of strategic linking. The strategic alignment results because the organization performance has to be done in such a way that it gives you better results in terms of individual incentives also. The resource allocation has to be done in such a way that the maximum benefit or the optimum utilization of the work relationships has to be done. The human resource development has to be done in such a way that each skill is utilized to its best possible aspect. This total kind of pooling up of resources in terms of interdependence requires a lot of cost and requires a lot of relationship aspects in terms of designing and building up the kinds of the networks which can create into trustworthy and in kinds of the political relationships. The organization basically has three lenses by which it is able to communicate to the world. That is the strategic design lens, the political lens, and the cultural lens. The strategic design lens is the most complicated design where genuinely the strategic alignments in terms of the political, cultural, social, economic, technological, all the aspects is done. When you talk about the political systems, it is basically the interest and the power of the people become important. The power in terms of money, the power in terms of expertise, and the power in terms of the gaining expertise in terms of technological advancement is also necessary. Here, both the internal stakeholders and the external stakeholders of the organization become important in dictating the various kind of interdependence designs for the organization. The sources of the powers could be the personal expertise, achievements, it could be the valued experiences, it could be the cultural relations or position shared in the organizations, and the kind of the networks you built beyond the organization expertise. The political power also comes with the size and with the nature of the organization. It is the efficiency, it is the position, and it is the information which we share with the world economics is important. Now let's see in this diagram, we have the kind of the redundant and the efficient networks. This is when a small relationship in a group is formed, this is the redundant relationship. When an organization gets connected to group A, B, C, D, E, F, and vast network is formed in this way, this is the kind of the efficient network built up. See the sources of power. The sources of the power basically come from the extended relationships and the interdependence which you built up with the various groups. This helps in the results in a better way because you have better focus, better energy, better flexibility, better understanding, and a kind of better expertise which is very scarce in the world. This kind of hierarchy in relationships or this kind of networks, whether formal and informal, both are assets for the growth of the organization. Using political lens is important in the organization because it focuses on the interest of the buyers. It focuses on the interest of the consumers in terms of political alignments to build a network which is genuinely efficient through the negotiation skills. And negotiation skills are built up on the basis of the informal aspects and the kind of the communication styles you take. For this, you basically have the advice network, you have the trust network, and you have the communication network. Now let's see the formal network which genuinely exists into the organization is you have a CEO who's working in organization. He is generally having the kind of the software applications, the field design, the integrated communication technologies, and the data control systems. So in this organization, the kind of hierarchy with the most of the people which he shares is a kind of a formal relationship. How does he convert this into the kind of the advice network? See, in the advice network, he will be connected to people beyond the organization and within the organization in kinds of networks where there is lot of exchange of information. And from this advice network, then you resort to the trust network. Now, this trust network is a hardcore communication network built of core people of core competency and high level expertise who genuinely stand in times of crisis. Or these are the people or the relationships which save you in terms of the basic economic changes happening into the world. And when the CEO trusts this kinds of the network, he is able to get success in life and in organization and in terms of the economic impacts which he puts into the global economy. Can you imagine the American economy, which is the richest economy in the world? The first five richest people of the American economy have assets equivalent to more than 40 underdeveloped countries. So this is the kind of the power imbalance we are having into the world. So putting this kind of balance into a network which genuinely shares the relationships of sharing would give you a kind of a governing systems where democracy in terms of the resource exchanges can take place and people who are in the underdeveloped economies can also benefit from the powers of the high oriented or achievement oriented people. Now, the cultural lens for the organization is another concept which you have to study in details in terms of the diversities existing into the organizations. Culture is basically and symbolic and a kind of expressive side of human life. It relates to the actions, objects and the ideas that carry specific meaning for specific people in terms of their relationships. Now, cultural perspective is important because this is carried through the logo, the vision, the mission, the objects, the lifestyles, the clothes, and the languages of the people. And every aspect has to be genuinely given importance, because you have to respect the different values of the cultures in terms of symbol, in terms of identity, in terms of the control equations, the subcultures, the cultural relativeness, and the kinds of the habits and the histories have to be studied before you design the cultural lens for the organization. Understanding organizational culture in the global economy for the world level companies is important, because here the organization relationship is designed by people who are residing in different cultures. The nature of human activity, the nature of reality and truth, and the nature of time and perspectives is changing in terms of lifestyle and in terms of habits. The nature of human race and human relationships has put a big impact on the business ethics. The kind of diversity which is existing in the world is changing the total systems of the world in terms of interdependence and interlinkages. Now let's study independence versus interdependence in the global economic systems. The interdependent economy is important because we have technology sharing, because we have the global supply chains, because we have the joint venture corporations, we have the free trade agreements and the kind of the mergers and the buyouts. In this kind of the global system, the brain and body of the total global economy is important. Now, when you see the 20th century kind of the economy, where various countries worked as different parts of the body, these parts never had any relationship with each other because they were closed systems. They worked with their own supply, with their own raw material, with their own finished products. They were independent of each other, not sharing anything. They were closed systems in terms of manufacturing their own products according to the local cultures and using the products according to their own lifestyles. But the 21st century has become the interdependent global economy, where the total world countries are connected in a kind of a human body. We have the brain, we have the head, we have the hands and the hearts of the global economy. Let's see the brains of the global economy. These are the innovative nations and the corporations who genuinely design and do the research for the total global economy. The brain economies of the world generally are the USA, Germany, Sweden, France and Japan. They have the power of the knowledge, they have the power of the money, and they have the power to build up the innovative products and solutions and technology for the human use. These are the countries which have the kind of the power in terms of the strategic alliances to put an impact on the world markets also. The markets of the underdeveloped companies are also impacted by the changes and the kind of the investments coming up into the brain economies. Then the domestic manufacturing economies of the other countries are guided by the kind of changes happening into these brain economies. The world economy is also impacted by the foreign direct investment happening into the brain economies. It is also genuinely impacted by the kind of the interdependence in terms of the mergers and joint ventures in the bigger companies happening in these countries. Now let's come to the body of the global economy. The body of the global economy are those countries which are hard working and they have ample supply of labor. These are the countries like China, Indonesia, Philippines, Mexico, Brazil, Pakistan, India and Eastern Europe. Now these countries are not very rich, but they have the power in terms of labor. They have the skillful people who can use the resources. They have a kind of a distribution of economic wealth in such terms that the labor cost becomes low over here. So the kind of the working equations can be better benefited by joining with these economies. The heavy dependence on FDI is essential for these countries, because any economy cannot work without the transfer of funds from one source to the another. So this kind of interdependence in terms of the global economy, where you share the kind of the relationships in terms of knowledge, in terms of labor, and in terms of economic goods, is becoming important. People are now using standardized products, though localized cultures have their basic perceptions for using their products, but most of the habits and the lifestyles are changing in relation to the kind of the world cultures, where you are in distinctive and universal cultures, where you have universal education standards, where you have universal law structures, you have democratic governance systems where your participation at global level is becoming important. And this kind of exchange and sharing of information has become important because no country cannot or can exist in a kind of existing or an independent state. The sharing of resources in terms not only of products and services is important, but in terms of technology and knowledge has become important. The knowledge sharing has resulted into kind of systems where we have built up a kind of technological parks in terms of connectivity and in terms of upgradation of each individual. The commitment, the kind of the sharing, the kind of the upgradation of human skills has resulted because you are accessing to the larger resources of the world. These resources genuinely have increased the pool of the resources in terms of not only technological and knowledge, but also in terms they have given you the cost advantages of the products which you used to buy at high cost at early times. But the cost has reduced because of the global competition. And this low cost products and services have increased the standards of living for all over the people in the global economy. This kind of global system in terms of exchange is important for understanding, for kind of respect, for building trust, and this has resulted into a situation where wars have become redundant. People have realized that if we exist in a kind of cooperation and mutual benefit relationships, this will result into prosperity of the total society. We are in a society where you have to live because other people are also living. We cannot live at the cost or at the expense of the other people's death. So their prosperity is important so that you can grow. And that is why the world has resulted into a kind of a global system which is devoid of wars and which is devoid of hardcore conflicts. Maybe we are existing in a world where the global system is depicted by the less or cold war systems, but genuinely the heated discussions and the heated conflicts are genuinely avoided in order to build up a mutual trustful society where the existence become easy. I hope the students must have understood the importance of interdependence in the global economy, how the organizations have taken their concept in the organizational relationships to build up the structures which can put impact on the strategic alliances, which can put an impact on the global participation, and how companies from local cultures have been transformed to the transnational companies, to the global companies. Thank you, students.